Your car began its life billions of years ago, billions of miles away in deep space.
The things that make up cars, those atoms, most of them were forged well before our Earth was born. You think your car is a clunker? It's actually 13.8 billion years old.
All right, let's do it, sir.
So what's the stuff that cars are made of? Best way to find out, tear one apart. Iron, plastics, oils, and rubber are the first to go.
In another half hour or so, this baby's gonna be completely crisp. I can't wait to see it.
Then aluminum, silicon, copper, and finally precious metals like platinum and gold. Each of these materials is crucial for building a car. But in the earliest days of the universe, none of them existed. Billion years ago, time and space are created in the Big Bang. The early universe is filled with nothing but energy.
After the Big Bang, it was just a chaotic glob of stuff, nothing like what you see today.
As the early universe cools, the energy gives way to unstable matter and antimatter, then protons and neutrons, and finally, atoms. But none of them are iron, silicon, or carbon. These vast gassy clouds are mostly hydrogen.
Something had to happen to give us everything else. And everything was actually made from hydrogen building blocks.
An atom of hydrogen is the simplest and lightest atom in the universe. Just a single positively charged proton bound to a single electron. The universe then builds up bigger atoms, like carbon and iron, by fusing hydrogen atoms together.
Everything starts from simpler origins. An iron atom is actually lots and lots of simple hydrogen atoms that were stuck together.
At first, this versatile proton building block doesn't want to stick.
Protons are positively charged. So as you push them closer together, they're gonna resist coming closer together. They really don't wanna hang out.
This repulsion makes the early universe a maelstrom of hydrogen atoms swerving to avoid each other.
But if you can get them to a point where you can shove them together enough, at some point, they're gonna lock together.
Pushing atoms together so strongly they stick is called nuclear fusion. It's the first key step for turning a universe full of gas into one filled with the ingredients for people, cars, and planets. So how do you get two atoms to fuse? This guy's been doing it in his garage since he was 14. Taylor Wilson is obsessed with nuclear fusion.
Okay, we're gonna get power from the laundry room now.
Taylor passes a high voltage through a small spherical cage that sits inside the reactor. The negatively charged cage quickly draws the hydrogen ions inside it.
So it's taking all those ions and sucking them towards the center. And as they fly in, they get confined, and hopefully they collide with each other and fuse.
The temperature of the atoms inside the cage is now so great that hydrogen atoms are fusing together, creating heavier helium atoms and a burst of energy hotter than the surface of the sun.
So that little tiny blob of plasma inside those grid wires, that's kind of like a star in a jar.
13 billion years ago, the universe uses gravity to fuse atoms instead of an electrical cage. Across the cosmos, vast clouds of hydrogen gas collapse under their own gravity. Pressure and temperature build as more and more gas gets sucked in. Eventually, fusion sparks deep inside the core of these giant balls of gas, and the first stars start to manufacture many of the heavy elements that make up your car today.
A star is basically a machine for turning lighter elements into heavier elements.
Fusion takes place only inside the core of these first stars, fusing hydrogen atoms together to create helium. And when all the hydrogen in the core is used up, the star finds a new fuel to burn.
After you burn hydrogen to form helium, the core of the star begins to collapse and get hotter. And there is enough energy then to fuse 3 helium nuclei into carbon. And then that fuses to form nitrogen, oxygen, silicon, iron.
But this incredible production line of elements can't go on forever.
The heavier atoms you ram together, the less energy you get out. So you turn hydrogen into helium, helium becomes carbon, nitrogen, oxygen. But every time, there's a bit less energy to be had until you get to iron.
The iron that is in your car is actually essentially a deadly poison when it comes to a star. It's robbing that star of the heat needed to keep itself up.
So the star collapses, dies, and explodes at the moment you create iron in the core. I mean, literally the fraction of a second. I'm not kidding. That's how dramatic and weird the steel in your car is.
The explosion, called a supernova, is one of the brightest and most violent events in the universe.
It releases enough energy to dwarf what the sun puts out over its entire lifetime. And all of the elements that it has created are then dispersed out into space.
The gassy remains of the explosion are called a supernova remnant, an expanding bubble of hydrogen gas from the outer layers of the star that mixes with stardust, the carbon, oxygen, silicon, and iron from its core. And this same 13 billion-year-old stardust helped you drive to work last week.
This was once in the core of a dying star. And who knows? Maybe some of the iron atoms in this brake disk were forged in the heart of the very first generation of stars that illuminated the universe. You're pumping iron, you're pumping the universe.
The first generation of stars created the materials in a car's chassis, body, windshield, and seats. But we're still missing key components, like the copper for the car's electrics. To create this crucial metal, a new generation of stars must die an even stranger death. Picture our universe as the very first stars come to the end of their lives. The early Milky Way is filled with flashes as star after star explodes. These violent supernovas hurl a rich cocktail of heavy elements into space. The carbon, silicon, aluminum, and iron atoms that will one day build our cars here on Earth.